One of the important things to recognize when we be, as we're students of the Bible, is the difference between the old covenant and the new covenant that Jesus brought. That's huge, because in the old covenant, they actually stoned people who made false prophecies. In the new covenant, we give them trophies. So I'm really glad we're in the new covenant, but it's a lot of fun. This morning, I want to talk to you about living a great life. I wonder if you feel like you are living a great life. When it comes to greatness, if you look at the world around us, greatness in athletics is measured in victories, in championships, in Super Bowl championships, in gold medals. Victories produce success, greatness in the world of athletics. In the world of entertainment, it's in awards. It's in blockbuster movies and Grammy Awards and Oscar Awards, and all of these awards are evidence of greatness in the field of entertainment. In the realm of politics, it's winning elections and achieving a high office is greatness, becoming a council member or a governor or a senator. All of that is greatness in the political realm. In the business realm, it's profit margins and building a Fortune 500 company and making a lot of money. That's what greatness is in the business realm. In education, it's advanced degrees. It's getting a college degree or a master's degree or a doctorate degree. By the way, you know the difference between a high school graduate and a college graduate? If you ask a high school graduate a question, they say, "I don't know." If you ask a college graduate a question, they say, "I forgot." But these are all the ways in which the world defines and measures greatness. If you're living a great life, you're making success in all of those different areas. But the question I want us to be challenged by this morning is this: how does God view greatness? What is greatness in God's eyes? How does Jesus measure greatness? Is there a greatness that goes beyond the measures of the world? And when you think about it, all of those measures of the world end in this world. But Jesus is going to teach us this morning, there is a greatness that goes beyond this world. In fact, it's the only greatness that goes beyond this world. And Jesus is going to show us in an episode with his disciples how God defines greatness, how he measures greatness, and he's going to spur us on to be those who live great lives in hurt terms of his kind of greatness. So we're going to read together this fairly well-known passage where Jesus is going up to Jerusalem and he's going to teach his disciples. He's going to teach Haumāna here at New Hope Kailua what the true measure of greatness is, how God measures greatness, defines greatness, and what it means for you and me to live a great life. They were on their way to Jerusalem. Now, this is huge. Because you know what's going to happen at Jerusalem. Jerusalem is going to be the place where Jesus is going to clash with the political, religious, financial powers, ultimately be rejected by him, by them, and be nailed to the cross. So he's going to a place of danger, and he knows it, and his disciples know it. With Jesus leading the way, this is a great picture. Jesus is the leader, and the disciples are following him. And the disciples were astonished. Why were they astonished? Because they knew full well there'd already been clashes with the religious leaders, that he was going into the jaws of the forces that were arrayed against him. While those who followed were afraid, again he took the 12 aside, and then he told them what was going to happen to him. If you read Mark's gospel carefully, three times as they go up to Jerusalem, three times Jesus predicts the cross. He tells them, "I'm going to be delivered into the hands of wicked men. They're going to crucify me. I'm going to rise from the dead." Three times. And so he says, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise." Jesus knew exactly what his mission was. He knew exactly where he was headed. And he's telling his disciples what's going to happen. James and John, Jesus talks about this great act of self-sacrifice, him going to the cross. James and John, they jump in with this request for self-promotion. What a contrast. Their leader is talking about the ultimate self-sacrifice. They're talking about self-promotion. How can we be the big kahunas in your political kingdom. That's what's going on. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come to him. Teacher, they said. They butter him up a little bit. We want you to do whatever we ask. They set him up. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked. They replied, let one of us sit at your right hand, the place of honor, authority, and power, and the other at your left, the second position of honor, authority, power. We want to be the big kahunas. We want to be great. We want to be great with you, Jesus. You're our leader, but we want to be great. Jesus says to them, you didn't know what you were asking. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. And he's speaking prophetically of what will happen. Actually, James will die for his faith later, decades down the road. John will be exiled on the island of Patmos and live out his life in prison, separated from his loved ones. So yes, they would suffer in following their leader, who is ultimately going to suffer in giving his life. But Jesus said, to sit at my right hand or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. Well, James and John come to Jesus and they say, we want to be great. We want to be the big shots in your kingdom. The rest of the disciples, they're eavesdropping and they say, yeah, we totally get that. We support James and John and we want to support their leadership. No, they don't. They are absolutely ticked off that James and John beat them. Beat them to the post. They're indignant. Look at the next section. When the 10 heard about this, when they heard that James and John were lobbying for being at the top of the list, what do they say? They became indignant. They became royally ticked off with James and John. Jesus called them together. Jesus, the leader, says, okay, here's a teachable moment. These guys in competition and selfishness are seeking greatness. Let me teach them what true greatness is all about. And that's what's going on. And here we see greatness in God's eyes, greatness in Jesus' kingdom, a great life that goes beyond this life. So Jesus says this, you know that those who were regarded as rulers of the Gentiles, those who exercise the world's greatness, the world's leadership, they lorded over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. I don't know if you watched the news this last week, but this is the way the world operates. They exercise authority and control in positions of greatness very often. And I hate to say it, as a former Canadian, I'm now American. But if you watch the news this last week, do you know what happened? You've seen all these truckers up in Canada. Now, whether you're on the side of the truckers or not on the side of the truckers isn't really the issue. They have a right for peaceful protest, and by all accounts, it's a peaceful protest, and they're civil disobedience, but that happens. But the government has the authority, whatever your view of the political issues is, the government has the authority to come in and haul away those trucks. They're parked where they shouldn't be. Government has that authority. They have the authority to fine the people that park their trucks there. Same thing for you and me. If I park my car somewhere it's not supposed to be, I can be fined, I can be towed. They have that authority. But what did the Prime Minister do? He declared national emergency. Talk about an overreach of power. Talk about a control of power. And I'm not trying to make a political statement. I'm just saying it's an example of taking control way beyond. He already had authority to stop the protest with legal forms. But he took is Canada under emergency? I don't think so. But he started seizing bank accounts. And not only that, the worst thing, I saw him with my own eyes, he started calling those with a different political view Nazis, terrorists, racists. Is this the way to serve people? Is this the way to solve problems? I don't think so. It's a great example of just taking power and exercising power. This is what Jesus is saying. This is how the world operates. And that's just one example that happened in the last week. We have to be careful wherever we're at that we don't operate in the world's power, which is just to exercise control and authority and power. But all of that to say, what does Jesus say is true greatness? What is greatness in God's eyes? He says this, not so with you. Not so with you, Haumāna. Not so with you, disciples of Jesus. Not so with you, Christ followers. This is not the way you operate. Instead, and here's the key point. Please note this. whoever wants to become great among you, you want to be number one? You want to be a big kahuna in the kingdom? That's not a bad thing, but it's how you get there. He says this, you must be a servant, must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be slave. Now, that's not a derogatory thing. A slave is a person who gives up their rights for another. Isn't that what Jesus did? And there are times where we need to give up our rights for others. He's saying this very clearly. Greatness in God's eyes, greatness in Jesus' kingdom is being a servant, is serving others, in caring for them. And he goes on to say, whoever wants to be, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life, pour out his life as a ransom for many. Jesus says this, true greatness is achieved by serving. The great life is the life of serving others. What God values is people who give their lives in service for others. That's the kingdom value for those of us that are followers of Jesus. The greatest example, and Jesus points to it. You want to see the true greatness? Jesus. Absolute greatness. He existed in the form of God. He's God the Son. And yet he emptied himself. And he came to this planet as a man. And think about that for a moment. Years ago, I had a friend who was a missionary in Pakistan. And he was a medical doctor. He went out into the rural parts of Pakistan to tell people about Jesus and to help heal them. And he told me about experience where in this rural community, but they were starting to build a modern city. So they had like modern homes, and they were putting in water in those homes and sewer systems in those homes, you know, toilets and waters and faucets. And so they were building modern homes with all the waterworks, but they hadn't built the infrastructure of a sewer yet. So he went into this city where literally there were houses and people living in the houses, and they flushed their toilets and they'd just go out, and guess where it go? Right into the street. Right into the street, because they hadn't built the sewer system. So my friend Don told me, he said, just to walk around there, he said, it made me wretch. I mean, I just about threw up just smelling the place, because you're walking around an open sewer system. And I thought about that, and I thought about the fact, when Jesus came into our world, he came from heaven, he came from a place of purity, he came from a place of sweetness, and he came into a world that was filled with the stench of sin. You and I may not smell that stench, we're kind of used to it, but every day, human lives pour out the stench of sin into our streets. You can't smell it physically. But you know, when Jesus came into our world, he came from a place of absolute purity into a place of stink. Just to become a man, just to come into our world. That's just the first step. But he didn't just come as any man. He came as a peasant. Not a celebrity, not a political leader, not an aristocrat, not a royalty. He came born in the body of a 16-year-old peasant and grew up in a peasant home and came in humility. He came a man, but he became a servant man. And you read his entire life. There's no one ever lived in human history that comes even close to what everything he did was serving others. When he started his public ministry, he taught people about the kingdom of God. He didn't start a school and charge tuition and make, no, he just taught the kingdom of God. He used his powers to heal people. He didn't start a medical clinic and start a, you know, a medical program and charge money. No, he just healed people. He just served people. When people were hungry, he set up a restaurant and charged expenses. No, he didn't. He just fed people. Everything he did was just serving, serving, serving. He poured out his life serving others. You talk about greatness. This is God the Son pouring out his life. And yes, in his greatest act of servanthood, what did he do? He went to the cross. He went to the cross and he gave up his rights and laid down his life and paid the penalty for your sins and for mine because of his heart of love for us. He serves us fully. He serves us perfectly. He is the servant of the Lord with a capital S. Jesus is the model, the leader of servanthood. He doesn't just talk what others should do. He does it. He did it. And he says to you and me, if you want to be my follower, if you want greatness, You want to follow my path of greatness? Guess what? You pick up the towel, and just as he washed his disciples' feet, and you wash other people's feet, and you become a member of the order of the towel, if you will. You join this movement of Haumāna. You join this movement of servanthood. That's greatness. That's what God considers greatness. That's what Jesus demonstrated as greatness. And if you want to be great in my kingdom, you become a servant. So how do we serve? How do regular people like you and me serve? Well, I'm going to spend a few minutes basically saying in every area of our lives, we have the opportunity to serve in all of these different ways. Serve in our family. Have you thought about that? If you're married, great way to be great in your marriage is to serve your spouse, to serve your wife, to serve your husband, to do the little things and the big things that bring blessing to them. Just to be a servant in your marriage. I didn't make that up. Paul says this in Ephesians 5. Submit to one another. And then he's going to apply that to marriage. What does it mean to submit to one another? Just put the other person first and care for their needs. Out of reverence for Christ, in your relationship with Christ, he's the servant of the Lord with a capital S. Take that spirit of servanthood into your marriage. And he says, wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. Put his needs, put your interests above your own. And then he says, husbands, sacrifice yourselves just as Jesus went to the cross. Love your wives just as Christ loved the church, gave himself up for her again. As Jesus put the needs and the interests of his bride above his own. Marriage is a beautiful place to practice this kingdom value of serving. Wonder if you see your marriage as a place to serve your spouse out of reverence, out of love for Jesus, and yes, out of love for your spouse, certainly. Parenting, do you realize? And this may be the most intuitive way, but as we raise our children, and again, Paul says, fathers, mothers, don't frustrate your children. And I put in the notes, I love Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of this. The text actually says, bring your children up in the training and instruction of the Lord. That's how you serve them. Eugene Peterson puts it this way, take your children by the hand from when they can just walk, and even before that, and lead them in the way of the master. That's how you serve them. And yes, when God gives us the gift of a child, if you're a parent, they start out helpless in life. I mean, they literally can do nothing. They would die without you. So how do you serve them? Well, it's obvious. Out of a heart of love, you feed them. You clothe them. You bathe them. I just saw yesterday something really cool. My son in Vancouver, they have a little baby who's, she's 6 or 7 months now old. And they're really good at sending us videos, so we feel like we're watching our granddaughters grow up. I saw something last night I'd never seen before. They had the kids in the bathtub, and she had this little ring. The baby, the 7, 8-month-old, had this little ring around her head. I thought, wow, where were these devices when we were raising our kids? It kept the little baby in the bathtub without her head going under the water. It was really cool. But it was just, you know, them bathing their children. That's what they eat. You keep them clean. You feed them. You clothe them. It's a lot of work. You get up in the middle of the night when they're hungry. You take care of them when they're sick. And as they grow older, how do you serve them? You help them learn to feed themselves so you don't have to feed them. And then you potty train them so you don't have to change their diaper. And then you teach them how to put their own clothes on so you don't have to dress them. And you're serving them, and you're serving them, and it's natural out of your love for them, but that's what you do as a parent. And it's greatness. It's part of greatness, just having a servant spirit, not a task, not a job, not an obligation, but simply a spirit of serving them and loving them. And yes, that serving and that loving results in all sorts of different expressions as they grow older. But parenting and marriage is a beautiful place to have this spirit of servanthood. Serve in your family, your nuclear family. Guess what? Serve in your church family. That shouldn't be a surprise. Here's one verse that says it all, 1 Peter 4:10. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. It says so much. Each of you, say what? I thought it was the pastor and the associate pastor and the worship pastor. Those are the folks that are supposed to serve. No, every member of the body is called to serve. Each of you in the family of God is called to serve. And you've been equipped for service because he says, whatever gift you have received. whatever gift. And that's why we started our Haumāna series saying, hey, do you know what your spiritual gifts are? There are four passages in the New Testament that speak about these Spirit-given gifts. And can you identify yours? Why? So you can release those and serve other people with the gifts that you have. I just had a little glimpse of that this last Tuesday that I wanted to share with you. There's a lady in our church. I don't want to put her on the spot or embarrass her, but her name's Priscilla. And she has a gift. I'm not sure it's a spiritual gift, but it's definitely a natural ability of making homemade cookies. So Tuesday night, I'm walking on the line and say, hey, Pastor Rick, did you know there's some homemade cookies out there? I happen to have the spiritual gift of eating homemade cookies. And it was just a little thing, but it was just a blessing of a member of the body using their abilities to bless others. It's just a picture of something far deeper than that, that God has given us spiritual gifts. And the New Testament says every believer in Jesus, the Holy Spirit, gives those gifts. Sometimes we need to discover them, and then we need to deploy them, and they're designed for the benefit of other people. They're designed for the benefit of the body of Christ. But that's a key way in which we serve. We serve in our church family. And it's faith, being faithful. So it says, you have received what? Why do you receive these gifts? It says, to serve others. To serve others. To pursue greatness with the spiritual gifts God has given you. As faithful stewards of God's grace. You didn't do anything to earn it. You don't deserve the gifts God has given you. But God has given you these gifts. And they're grace gifts. They're out of his goodness, and they're designed to bless other people and for the body of Christ to grow, to be blessed in its various forms. There's a whole diversity of gifts, and they all operate together for people's blessing and the glory of Jesus. So serve in your nuclear family. Serve in your church family. By the way, years ago, I read this a parable. It's obviously not a true thing, but it's a little parable of the difference between heaven and hell, okay? And here's what happened in this little parable. A priest had a vision, and he's sleeping in the middle of the night, and he has a vision, and this angel lifts him up to a place called hell. And he's in this room, and here's the vision he has of hell. There's a round table and a group of people sitting around the round table. And in the middle of the round table, catch this, is his favorite food, beef stew. This priest loves beef stew, okay? And there's people sitting around and a pot in the middle of the table of beef stew, but here's the problem. Every one of the person at the table, they have a ladle to dip into the beef stew, but the ladle is longer than their arm. The ladle's longer, so they can get beef stew, but they can't feed themselves. The ladle's too long. So people are trying to get that beef stew and feed themselves, and they can't do it, and the people are emaciated, and there's weeping, and there's gnashing of teeth, and there's suffering. And the priest says, oh, to the angel, take me away from here. I can't stand seeing all this suffering. That was his vision of hell. So the angel took him to a vision of heaven, and guess what he saw? A round table, exactly like the other round table, people sitting around the table. And guess what's in the middle? His favorite food, beef stew, sitting in a pot. And all of these people, they had a ladle in their hands that was longer than their arm. It was longer than their arm. But guess what they were doing? They were dipping into the beef stew, and then they were serving other people. They were dipping into the beef stew, and there was joy, and there was blessing, and there was life. That's a key difference between heaven and hell. And what Jesus is saying, my followers are those who have learned this kingdom value of serving one another. And it happens in the church family. It happens in your nuclear family. Here's another way. It happens at work. Do you realize that your workplace is a great place to have a servant spirit, to pursue greatness? Not just a task. It's not just a paycheck. It's not just a way to make money. But if you enter into Jesus' kingdom value and see yourself at the office or wherever you are in the marketplace, this is an opportunity for me to serve people. And again, I didn't make this up. Paul says in Ephesians 5, he talks about slaves and masters. He's talking about the marketplace. Unfortunately, we don't have slaves. But sometimes at the office, you may feel like a slave. But we have, in the principles in this passage relate very well to the marketplace because we have employees, we have employers, you have supervisors, you have people under you, you have people in charge of you, all of us do, and you can transfer these principles. And what does it say? Serve. This is an opportunity to serve. Serve wholeheartedly. Don't just put in hours. Don't just, you know, grind it out to get a paycheck. But serve. Have a servant spirit. Serve with your heart wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord. Make Jesus your boss at work. And then that will lead you to serve. And then he says to the supervisors, to the masters, the same thing. Treat your servants, treat those underneath you in the same way. Serve them. If you're a leader, if you have a position of influence, you use that position of influence to serve people, servant leadership. And that's what the scriptures call us to. When you think about it, every job, I don't know one, is an opportunity to serve people. If you're a teacher, what are you there for? To serve your students. If you're an accountant, you're there to serve your clients. If you're in the business, you're there to serve your customers. If you're a truck driver, you're there to serve those that you work for. In every job, there's an opportunity to see yourself as a servant of people. And you can pursue greatness in your job by just recognizing my role isn't just to try and get to the highest position, competitiveness. No. My job is to serve people. Whatever opportunity, whatever position God has given me, that's a platform for serving people. And if you capture that vision, that spirit, then you've captured something of what Jesus said. This is greatness. When you capture this vision of serving people in your family, in your church, in your work, and yes, in your community. There are great opportunities to serve in your community. And I love the fact that members of our church family here, some of them serve in the community by hosting a recovery group and helping people getting out of substance abuse issues. They're there to serve people. Nobody even pays them. They just do it to care and serve for people. We have others who coach teams. We have a cross-country coach. We have a volleyball coach. And they're there to serve. They're there to shine their light. Here's a great passage, and it's there in your Bible. Jesus said this, "Let your light shine before others through your life of servanthood, through your life of good works, that they may see your good deeds, that they may see that you're a servant of Jesus, and what? Give glory to Father in heaven." Why would that person have such a servant spirit to others? Because obviously God's operating in their life. And great opportunities in every arena of life to simply follow what Jesus. You want greatness? You want to live the great life? Capture this heart. Be captured by this heart of servanthood that Jesus shows us above all. Now, one of the things that I want us to realize that I hope will be an incentive, an encouragement to us, is that Jesus wants to fill our lives with his blessing. He wants us to experience these good gifts. And before I go on, I just noticed, just so you're aware of some of the opportunities right here in our church, if you're interested, say, hey, I'm new to the church, I'd love to get involved in serving in the church. We have, I count them up, 18, 20 different ways. I'm just going to read them. But if we can support you in serving Jesus in any capacity, in your marriage, in your work, whatever, but certainly in our church ministries. We have children's church. We have Feed the Hungry ministry. We have a greeters ministry. We have a halal dance ministry. We have a hospitality ministry. It's a little bit on hold right now with COVID, but it's coming back. I'm believing it. We have junior high and high school. We have Levites. We have Love Your Neighbor, which is just caring, getting teams together to care for people in the community with various needs. We have a prayer team. If you have a prayer gift, we'd love you to be a part of the prayer team. We have programming arts. We have video. We have photography. We have small groups. We have a sign team. I heard this morning about someone the Lord directed to our church just because we have a group of servants who put out signs to let people know where we're meeting. Beautiful thing. We have soul food for people that need a meal at various times. These are just various ways in which you can be captured by this spirit of serving one another. We have multimedia. We have production. We have sound teams. We have tech teams. We have ushers. We have a website that if you have skills in that, we could use help with that. We have a worship team. These are just, you know what they are? They're opportunities for greatness. They're opportunities for greatness where you can just be a part of a team serving, and it doesn't have to be necessarily every week, but sometimes we have a rotation schedule, and you can be a part of a team that just serves, and brings life to the body of Christ. So I didn't want to forget that. But let me just mention some benefits of serving, because there are good gifts that Jesus wants to deposit in your life and in my life when we are captured by the spirit of servanthood, the spirit of pursuing greatness in God's eyes. Number one benefit of serving is joy. You will trigger joy in your life. How many of you could use a little bit more joy in your life? Thank you. Me too. We all could, especially during these pandemic days. When you get activated in serving and serving others, and especially with your spiritual gifts, there's a link there, and it will trigger joy in your life. Jesus says, now that you know these things, you will be blessed. Your life will be enriched. You will experience joy. He says this, if you do them. If you just know about it but don't do it, you won't experience it. But when you do it, it'll trigger blessing. It'll trigger a richer life and joy. He says specifically in John 15, I have told you this so that what? Jesus' joy, my joy, may be in you, and that your joy may be complete. I want you to know completeness of joy. And that will be triggered, that will be released on this path of being a servant, following the ultimate servant, Jesus himself. Growth, you will experience spiritual growth, because he's designed the body to grow when people serve one another. He's created this family of serving. He's blazed the trail of serving. And when people get captured by this vision of serving, there's individual spiritual growth, and there's corporate spiritual growth, family growth. And quite frankly, you will never grow if it's just you and Jesus in your faith and not serving other people, because he's designed that growth. It's kind of like a spiritual muscle. Once you start exercising that muscle, it leads to health and growth. Here's a key verse, Ephesians 4. From Jesus, from him, the whole body. What's that? The family of God, the corporate, the believers together, the body of Christ, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, every member, every part. What happens? Grows and builds itself up in love. Beautiful picture. What? As each part serves, as each part does its work. One of the reasons why we want to always build this vision and this practice of serving one another in our church family is because we all need each other. We need every member, and we'll never be fully the church. Spirit just blew my notes away. Remind us again that what God wants us to do is grow together, grow individually, grow together as a church family, and serving one another and releasing the spiritual gifts God has given us is key to that. So what are the benefits of serving? What does God want to deposit in your life? More joy, more growth, fulfillment. That you will actually have a sense of, that's why God put me on this planet. I don't have to wonder what life is. That's how God has designed me. That's how he's gifted me. That's what he's called me to do. And there'll be a sense of fulfillment. And here's one of my favorite passages. We've often read this, Ephesians 2:10. We are God's handiwork. We are his masterpiece. We're his artwork. We're a new creation. We're created in Christ Jesus. What? To do good works, to serve, to serve others with what he's given us, spiritual gifts, natural abilities, opportunities, to do a life of good works that's serving other people, which, catch this, God prepared in advance. He had a plan. He had a kingdom vision. He created you with certain gifts and opportunities and place and time and family background and everything else. What do you have that didn't come from God? Answer, nothing. Everything you have comes from God. And he says, with that, I've got this eternal kingdom vision, and here's your part of it. This is what I've designed you to do. And when you get that our lives are to live out this kingdom vision, this calling, this plan that God had for our lives, which is why he wired us the way he did, which is why he put you where he put you, which is what he wants to accomplish uniquely through your life, you'll say, yeah, we're all working to discover that, to live it out. But this is why he put me on the planet. And you'll have a sense of fulfillment of what he has created you to do. So, joy, growth, fulfillment. Don't miss this. Jesus wants to reward us. He's the one who tells the story. He does it a couple of different stories, but I've just given you the one in Matthew. You know, the parable of the bags of gold, or the talents, which is not physical talents, it's a measure of money, a measure of silver. And he gives his servants, that's the story Jesus tells, the master who owns the stuff, he owns the money, but he gives them to his servants in different measures. And then he digs out for a different place and he comes back and he basically says, what did you do, Rick, with what I gave to you, what I loaned, what I gave to you to steward through you? And there's accountability. And what we all want to hear, whether we're given one measure of money, opportunity, giftedness, whatever it is, three or five, he says, what we want to hear is what Jesus says in the story. Well done, good and faithful, what does he call them? Servant, because they served. They followed this path of greatness, and they served the king with what he gave them. And well done, good and faithful, servant. You were faithful with a few things. You served faithfully with the opportunities, with the gifts, with the education, with the intelligence, with everything I gave you. I will put you in charge of many things. There will be a reward for your faithful servant. In Luke's version of the thing, he says, I will put you over 10 cities. And even in this passage, the idea is the reward for faithful service is more service in the kingdom of God, in the new creation, in the new heavens, and the new earth. But there are rewards there. And what we do with what we're given in this life directly affects what our service will be in the life to come. And so Jesus wants to reward you and realize that your investment in his kingdom, in serving others, in all of these avenues we've looked at, is an investment in the future, in life. This is the greatness that goes beyond this life. It's the only greatness that does. All of the other worldly great, they end in this life. But serving others and contributing to Christ's kingdom is the thing that goes beyond this life. Final thing is greatness, and we come back to Jesus' words. When you live this life of serving others, then you are pursuing the path of greatness in God's eyes. Greatness, true greatness, as Jesus defines it. These are all things that Jesus aspires for, if you will, in our lives, and should be incentives for us to say, yeah, this is all good reason for me to say, as I follow the servant of the Lord, with a capital S, my leader, the one who loves me with the first love, with his first love, I want to love him, and I want to serve him, and I want to conclude this morning by pointing to the heart of the matter, because let's never lose sight of this. Serve out of a heart of love. He calls us to serve, but just as he served out of a heart of love, he calls us to serve out of a heart of love. So that's why Paul says under the Spirit in Galatians, serve one another humbly as Jesus came in humility, in love, out of a heart of love. Not obligation, not out of some sense that I've got to be a faithful member of a church, or I've got to be, you know, I'm obligated to do this for my wife or my, no, not out of obligation, not out of duty, not even out of guilt. Sometimes we can do the right thing just out of guilt, but out of a heart of love. Love for Jesus and love for people. Serve one another humbly in love. And I love what Paul says himself. He's a model. He says this, for Christ's love compels us. Everything he does is compelled by the love of Christ. Is he talking about Christ's love for him or his love for other people? Answer is both. And the grammar, it's the love of Christ, and it could be the love of Christ in my heart flowing to people, or the love of Christ. And those two go together. We've seen that as our hearts are captured with Christ's love, it overflows and we love others and we serve others out of a heart of love. And Paul says again, we saw last week, these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But here's the Mobetta one. Here's the great one, love. And love is that motivating factor in our service. Love is greater than spiritual gifts. Love is Mobetta. Love is that thing that if you have it, you have everything. If you don't have it, you got nothing. That was last week's message. But this week is that love flows into serving. Serving one another in all of these arenas in life. Perhaps you heard the parable of the man or the woman who was climbing a ladder, and they're climbing that ladder for their entire life, and at the end of their life they're at the top of the ladder, but to their great horror they realize they've been climbing this ladder, but the ladder is leaning against the wrong wall. And, you know, we can do that. We can pursue greatness and at the end of our life say, I just really missed it. building a great company, that's not wrong in itself, but if that was my goal in life, making a lot of money, being successful, all of those things, none of them are bad in themselves, but if it's all about self-promotion, you're climbing up the wrong wall. What you want to do at the end of your life is climb up that ladder of servanthood, serving ultimately Jesus, serving people, and then at the end of your life, you say, wow, you hear those words from Jesus. You were pursuing a ladder of true greatness, of greatness that goes beyond this life, of greatness as God sees it. So when he says to you and to me, this is what our dream is, not only well done, good and faithful servant, but that was a great life. You lived a great life because you lived a life of service, just as my son Jesus lived a life of service. That's our goal. That's our aspiration. Let's stand and pray together and encourage one another to live a life of greatness as we follow Jesus. Father, once again, we thank you for the way that you have revealed kingdom heaven's values to us through Jesus above all else. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are the model of greatness, the measure of greatness, our example of greatness. We're inspired by your greatness, that even though you had a position that is beyond our imagination, creator of the universe, fully God, yet you emptied yourself and you came as a man, and not just any man, but a servant. And not just any servant, but a servant who poured out his life even to death. And not only any death, but the death on the cross where you suffered for our sins. Thank you for the power of your love that rose from the dead. Lord, it's a delight to be your sons and daughters. Stir us by your Spirit to even further in each of our journeys to live out what it means to follow you, to follow your model of greatness by serving others. Thank you for the opportunities you give each one of us in all of these arenas of life. I pray that you would stir us this week by your Spirit to be captured by the Spirit of Jesus, the Spirit of serving those that you have put in our lives in every arena. We love you. We thank you for this beautiful day. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Lord bless you. And again, join us Tuesday evening.
Aloha, church family. Thank you so much for joining with us in worship this morning. We truly hope that you were refreshed and strengthened in your faith during these crazy pandemic days. We invite you to look at all of our messages. They're available on our YouTube channel. We'd also invite you to download our church app. It's just a great way for us to keep in touch, to communicate, also for you to receive materials. So take advantage of downloading that church app. We would invite you to partner with us as we continue serving God faithfully during these days. And you can give online, you can give on our website, or mail a check into our street address. We really appreciate your support with that. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord turn his face upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord grant you peace. We love you. Aloha.